Thanks to KiwiCo for sponsoring today's video. Often, on a clear day, I will briefly glance at the sun and be in awe about how big and bright it is in our sky. It's hard to think that it's millions of kilometers away, yet it has such a massive impact on us here on Earth. Life would be impossible without the sun. Almost everything can be traced back to the light and energy it provides. Even though it's relatively close to us and not exactly hard to spot, there's still a lot we don't know about it. Which is why both NASA and ESA have sent spacecrafts to study the sun in the last 2 years. These missions will be the closest we've ever been to our star, so close in fact that they will be able to directly interact with its atmosphere. So why are we sending these spacecrafts to the sun? What will they do there? What have they found so far? And what makes each of these missions special and unique? I'm Alex McColgan and you're watching Astrum. And in this video, we will investigate NASA's Parker Solar Probe and ESA's Solar Orbiter, and how they will explore our own magnificent star, the Sun. The Parker Solar Probe was announced in 2009 and was launched on August 12, 2018 on a Delta IV Heavy rocket. It will use 7 Venus flybys over nearly 7 years to gradually shrink its orbit around the Sun. At its closest point, it will only be about 6.16 million kilometers away, which is inside the Sun's corona, or its atmosphere. Being that close would feel like 500 suns in the sky beating down at the same time, with the temperature reaching up to 1,400 degrees Celsius. The spacecraft is going 7 times closer to the Sun than any spacecraft has gone before, and at these temperatures, many components that are used to make sensitive equipment for spacecraft would melt away. To protect the spacecraft and all its equipment, it is shielded by an 11-centimeter thick carbon composite shield, which can withstand these high temperatures. This shield also has a white reflective surface that can help minimize heat absorption. The shield will always be facing the sun, protecting the spacecraft in this harsh environment. Being far away from Earth and orbiting a very dangerous object, this spacecraft is, by necessity, as autonomous as a space mission has ever been. Because the heat shield always has to be facing the Sun, for large sections of its orbit, it won't be able to point its antenna at Earth. During these times of communication blackout, it will control each of the sensors, control the formatting of data products, and archive high-resolution data, until it can communicate with Earth again and transmit back what it has captured. ESA's Solar Orbiter mission began development in 2012, and after 8 years, the Solar Orbiter was launched on February 10th, 2020 on an Atlas V rocket. The Solar Orbiter will also use gravity assist from Venus, as well as Earth. These swingbys will put the Solar Orbiter into an initial 180-day orbit around the Sun. The spacecraft will reach the closest approach to the Sun every 6 months, at around 43 million kilometers away. This is comparatively much further away than the Parker probe's closest approaches, but just to give you an idea of the temperatures at this distance still, at 43 million kilometers from the Sun, the temperature can reach up to 500 degrees Celsius, as the sunlight will be 13 times more intense than what we feel on Earth. The Solar Orbiter is protected by a heat shield made with titanium foil layers about 40 centimeters thick, which is not as effective as the Parker probe's heat shield, but still enough to protect the spacecraft on its dangerous mission. It is surprisingly difficult to get a probe into a close orbit around the Sun, as it takes 55 times more energy to go to the Sun than it does to go to Mars. You see, the Earth is always moving sideways relative to the Sun at very high speeds, about 30 kilometers per second, or 108,000 kilometers per hour. In order for a probe to successfully enter into an orbit around the Sun, it must cancel out almost all of that motion. This is why both the Parker and Solar probes were launched using two of the most powerful launch vehicles available at the time, the Delta IV and the Atlas V. The objectives of the Parker Solar Probe and the Solar Orbiter are similar to a great extent. Both these missions aim to find out more about our Sun's corona, its solar winds, coronal mass ejections, the structure of the Sun's magnetic field, and simply how it all fits together. The Sun, like all stars, is a ball of plasma. Plasma is superheated matter, so hot that the electrons are stripped away from the atoms, leaving an ionized gas. The Sun has an atmosphere of extremely hot but tenuous plasma extending out for millions of kilometers called the Sun's corona. You can see the plasma atmosphere in this image, although typically it is far harder to see than the Sun itself, as the Sun's outer layer, known as the photosphere, is much brighter. The ideal time to spot the Sun's corona is during a solar eclipse, when the Moon blocks out the photosphere disk, leaving just the wispy arms of the corona visible. The strange thing about the Sun's corona is that its temperature is between 1 million and 3 million degrees Celsius, whereas the Sun's surface temperature is only about 5,500 degrees Celsius, and currently we don't really know why. And while the Sun's corona looks substantial, its brightness is deceiving. It is actually magnitudes less dense than Earth's atmosphere. The Sun continuously releases huge amounts of plasma and radiation into space, which is known as the solar wind. Solar wind is not very strong or dense, and the Earth's magnetic field diverts most of it harmlessly away. While a lot of solar wind does get redirected around the planet, some gets funneled towards the planet's poles, where ions from the solar wind collide with atmospheric oxygen and nitrogen atoms, the interactions of which emit the beautiful colors we see in auroras. The number of particles ejected by the Sun is not constant. Reconnection events in the Sun's magnetic field can release huge amounts of energy in the corona, ejecting millions of tons of charged particles into space in one big eruption. This is what is known as a coronal mass ejection, or a CME. When these CMEs interact with the Earth's magnetosphere, it causes what's called a geomagnetic storm, and the biggest of these storms can be devastating. The largest geomagnetic storm ever to hit Earth was the Carrington event back in 1859. If such a CME was to hit Earth now, the resulting storm could affect satellites and our electric power supply in what could be described as a hemisphere-wide EMP bomb. As we depend on electricity and the internet so much, even a few hours of outage could cause serious problems. Some estimates show that if a Carrington-sized event happened today, it could cause a few trillion dollars in damages. And unfortunately, CME flares are fast. They've been shown to reach Earth in just 17 hours. This might not be enough time to alert the entire population, turn off reactors, and take necessary precautions. In reality, we have simply been lucky up until this point, as we missed a Carrington-sized event hitting us by a margin of 9 days in July 2012. Had it been 9 days later, Earth would have been a bit further in its orbit and in the CME's path. This is why it's so important for us as a delicate species to understand the Sun's corona so we can better predict solar storms, to give us better warning and hopefully avoid damages associated with a Carrington-sized event actually hitting us. It's just a matter of when rather than if. Now, these two probes may seem similar, and while a lot of their goals do overlap, they both have some unique features. The Parker probe is going deep into the Sun's corona, where no man-made object has gone before. Because it has to withstand such high temperatures, the spacecraft is limited in some ways. For example, it cannot take pictures of the Sun, as no current camera technology could look directly at the Sun from that close and survive. But the Parker probe has instruments that can directly sample and collect data about the particles that exist in the Sun's corona, and even closely study the regions where solar winds originate, something that can't be done at a distance. The Parker probe is lighter, smaller, and has less equipment compared to the solar orbiter. The solar orbiter, on the other hand, carries both particle detectors and telescopes. It can take close-up pictures of fascinating solar landscapes, and due to its orbit, it will be able to track a region of the solar atmosphere for much longer than is possible from Earth. This will enable it to observe storms building up in the atmosphere over several days. So, as you can see, these probes are complementary, and both will help further our understanding of the Sun's corona in their own way. So, what have these missions achieved so far? Well, on the 27th of September 2020, the Parker probe passed within 13.5 million kilometers of our star, the closest any spacecraft has ever been. Also, it became the fastest traveling human-made object ever, traveling at 466,000 kilometers per hour. And this isn't even as close or as fast as it's going to get. Still, even at this distance, the data sent back from the Parker probe is already helping our understanding of how the sun's magnetic field and the corona interact to form solar winds. The probe also discovered that some magnetic fields from the sun sweep through the solar atmosphere, which can increase the solar wind speeds by as much as 500,000 kilometers per hour. In addition, it has discovered evidence of a dust-free zone 5.6 million kilometers from the sun. It's believed this is due to the vaporization of cosmic dust particles by the sun's radiation. The solar orbiter has already sent back its first images of the sun, and scientists found something called campfires, which you can see here. These are explosions on the sun's surface that occur as a result of disturbances in small magnetic fields. The solar orbiter also took the closest images in existence of the sun's surface from 77 million kilometers away. And the examination of particles across its orbit will help us understand the different types of space weather. So, all in all, these missions still have some exciting times ahead. Getting ever closer to the sun will help us understand it like never before. Want to keep up to date with these amazing missions findings as they happen? Then be sure to subscribe for more. Does space inspire you to learn like it does for me? Actually, I was a child when I first started getting interested in it, and this is where KiwiCo can help ignite that interest in children close to you, with their monthly hands-on projects designed to expose kids to concepts in science, technology, engineering, art, and math. They sent through a space-themed crate this month aimed at children my daughter's age, and she was able to feel the different shapes of the planets with a tactile play toy, along with a small book on space, a wooden planet she can paint, and various other resources. KiwiCo offers 8 subscription lines to their monthly crates, each catering to different age groups, from toddlers to teens, and a variety of topics, with the main goal being to help your child learn, create, and problem solve. The seeds you plant today might flourish into a lifetime of interest. You can get 50% off your first month of any crate by going to kiwico.com/astrum, which you can find in the description. They are a really good price anyway, and I highly recommend checking them out. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video about the Parker probe and the solar orbiter missions, be sure to like and subscribe, and also check out some other spacecraft videos here. A big thank you as well to my patrons and members who support the channel. If you would like to support too, check out the links in the description below. All the best, and see you next time.